Okay, so hello everyone. We're starting off now with the recording for today's screencast, and Isaac, the technical community evangelist for the MIFOS initiative, will be presenting on how to create a custom microservice on top of Apache Finrack CN. This will be part of a series of webinars and tutorials we'll provide from the MIFOS initiative to the broader Apache Finrack community, to help individuals get up to speed on the new next-generation cloud-native microservices architecture. We'll also be working with the community to try and provide both a developer portal as well as hosting toolkits and other resources to help the community navigate this new architecture. So thank you, Isaac, for leading the webinar today. And I'll let you, lay the ground rules for the webinar, whether or not you want questions throughout the webinar or held to the end. But I'll pass it over to you, Isaac. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Ed. Good afternoon, everyone. It's afternoon here in the beautiful mountainside town of Buya, Cameroon. As Ed Kebo said, I'm Isaac Kamga. I'm the technical community evangelist for the MIFOS initiative. I studied a bit of background about myself. I studied computer science at the University of Buea, where I got introduced to open source development about 5 years ago through the Google Summer of Code program. I later drew my community's attention to the importance of open source development and started working at Skylabbers Incorporated, a silver platform solution partner with the MIFOS initiative, which was founded by a friend and classmate, Ayokita. So today I'll be presenting to you a webinar where I'll create a custom microservice called SMS Alert in Apache Finrack CN, which sends an SMS to a member of a microfinance institution when their account gets created at that MFI. So I hope this goes a long way to help the developers in the broader community to contribute to Apache Finrack. And because there has been a lot of interest in those respects recently. So a little disclaimer: the SMS Alert microservice is not yet production ready, right? This webinar, the idea of this webinar is for us to do a call for developers in our community to join in, so we build this open source project which actually ends poverty one line of code at a time. So this SMS Alert microservice will need a little bit more effort to actually get it become a product. I'll push the code to GitHub and forward the link to the mailing list. Hopefully from there you can get it and, tinker with it a little bit. For those of you who are actually, who aim at being proficient developers on this Apache Finrack CN, my advice to you would be to learn Java 8, especially with special focus on lambdas and streams, the functional programming aspect of Java. Learn Spring Core, learn Spring Boot and Spring Cloud. You really need those four to actually, really understand the code. We're using the Gradle build system, so we're not using Maven, because when this platform was being developed initially, the architect Makujis actually did not want any XML in the whole platform. So we're using just Java. So you want to use Gradle for your build. So now, let's have an overview of Apache Finrack CN. So what is Apache Finrack CN? Apache Finrack CN is a global standard for financial inclusion, which is governed by the Apache Software Foundation. And that foundation is the world's most prestigious open source governance body, hosting over 300 open source projects. The Apache Finrack CN project was born out of the MIFOS initiative as MIFOS IO. And MIFOS actually has decades of domain expertise and has a global community which actually helped to define the several domains within financial inclusion. Finrack CN is based on a microservice architecture, which is implemented using Spring Boot. Remember, I insisted a few seconds ago about developers learning Spring Core, Spring Boot and Spring Cloud to develop on this platform. The initial CN actually stands for Cloud Native. So Cloud Native there means that the microservices are designed and built to fit in seamlessly with cloud computing technology like continuous integration, orchestration, container engines, and you know, all of this new cloud computing technology. So the platform uses various data stores, such as Cassandra and MariaDB, to enable extensibility, whether internally or externally, and actually also to help for scalability. Yeah, so now I'll go over two important design patterns which are used in Apache Finagak CN. These are domain-driven design and command query responsibility segregation, or CQRS. Everything about Apache Finagak CN begins with domain-driven design. Remember I told you that the project was born out of the MIPOS initiative. MIPOS initiative has a lot of experience carving out the different domains within financial inclusion, right from the Grameen Foundation up to the MIPOS initiative, and you know. So domain-driven design is something which you don't want to joke with when you're working with Apache Finagak CN. Domain-driven design is not so much of a new concept. It was conceived like in the early 90s. And actually, it simply states that in order to create a product, you need a domain expert. In the case of Apache Finagak CN, MIPOS initiative provided a lot of domain experts. And they actually helped a lot to develop all the domains, whether loans or accounting, organization, all of those domains were actually developed with the expertise of the MIPOS community. The next important step in developing your domain is developing a coherent language. So you have to use the same terms which have the same meanings within the same bounded context. For example, let's ask a question, what's the meaning of user within the context of Apache Finagak CN? When you use the word user, are you referring to a field operator, or are you talking about a member of a microfinance institution? So within each context within which you are working, you need to define exactly a coherent language. So when a term like employee is used, you know that you're referring to a worker in a financial institution. When a word like account is used, we know you are referring to a financial account in a microfinance institution. So with domain design, you need domain expertise, you need a coherent language. Now, when you get the right language into your mix, the next thing you start to do is to specify a complete feature set for your solution. By complete there, normally we understand that a platform will never really be complete. It's just that it works for the customer at a particular point in time. So you get to specify a complete feature set for your solution. The next step is that for each of these broad explanations of your system, you need to break each of them down into smaller, finer functionalities. For example, sending a journal entry, or creating a client, or doing a repayment of a loan. Those would be tiny little functionalities which are really scoped out so that you know this type of functionality which you want to cover, so that those different functionalities, when you have broken them into smaller, finer functionalities, the next step you want to do is to find the bounded context of these functionalities. A bounded context simply is a set of dependencies and logical alignments in your functionality set that naturally groups your functionalities together into a single domain. So let's say if we have finer functionalities like, creating, setting a journal entry, debiting the trial balance, all of that can be grouped into the accounting domain, right? And that will fall under the domain of financial accounting. So that these are actually some steps we use to actually develop our domain. So by this point, we have taken a look at it. We have divided, we have decided on a coherent language. We have divided broad functionality into smaller functionalities, and then we have grouped these different functionalities into different domains within financial inclusion. Why did we do all of this? We wanted to use a pattern, a new technology called microservices to allow for better scalability. Since scalability matters in today's world and the way we serve technology, and even enable easier extensibility of our system by dividing the huge monolithic application, which we had, Apache that huge monolithic one, into small pieces called microservices, which run their own processes and can scale individually. So that was just the idea of choosing to use microservices so that you can easily extend and each can scale in their own respects. So the first step was taking the bounded context domains and defining them into microservices. We simply took the domains we had found. I'll show you the domains a few slides from now. And we created microservices for each of these domains. So now, as I said, the benefits of using the microservices is that over time you have, when you have an increase in transactions, for example, within certain time slots, you could simply scale based on your own need. When transaction rates go down, you scale down. When transaction rates go up, you scale up. So this is cheaper than using servers which run at the same capacity all the time and which never really get used except during specific time slots of the day when transactions are really high, let's say midday or something. So we chose those microservices so that there should be scalability within each of those domains. So another good aspect of microservices besides scalability and extensibility is that you can shape them the way you like. For example, you could customize the API which enables different microservices to talk to each other to your own needs, and it's an entire microservice just for that. So good thing is that it's open source. You take a look at the code, understand it, and you can always make it better. Okay, so now here are some domains in financial inclusion which have been implemented as microservices in the Apache Finerax CN project. So, I mean, these are classical domains within financial inclusion, right? There's actually nothing new about transaction processing, portfolio accounting, organization, and reporting. I'll just explain to you a little bit about which domain is implemented by which microservice. We have security. The security domain is implemented using the identity microservice. And this identity microservice, it provides services for REST resource-based calls to users, defining roles and permissions. So that's a security microservice. There is the audit domain, which is implemented using the command microservice. And this provides information on state changes within the entire system. Mm-hmm. There's transaction processing, which is implemented using a teller microservice. And it's a unified interface for external transactions, which are later translated into internal language. There are other, recently two microservices were added to the repositories, which aid transaction processing. These are payroll payments, the payroll microservice, which enables microfinances to handle payroll payments for their members. So maybe if a microfinance has members who work for maybe their local government, and they have some agreement to receive their salaries through that microfinance, then we'll definitely be using a lot of the payroll payments microservice. So there's also the checks microservice, which supports transaction processing, and it provides services which are used to issue, validate, and implement transactions using checks. Yeah. So let's go on to another domain. There's a portfolio domain which is implemented using the portfolio microservice, as well as the deposit account management microservice. And the portfolio domain handles, these two microservices handle individual and group loans. They handle checking and savings accounts, account management. So basically anything that has to do with loans, whether for individuals or groups, and checkings and savings, that's handled by portfolio microservice. There's also this microservice which provides information on customers and some know your customer functionality. It's implemented using the customer microservice in Apache Finerac CM. Now, there is the organization domain, which is implemented using the Office microservice. So it provides you the ability to configure the structure of an MFI. So if you have an MFI, you have a particular structure, you have a particular number of employees who will be using the platform, they want to configure that using, it's implemented using the Office microservice. And of course, there's the accounting microservice, the accounting domain, which is implemented using the accounting microservice. It manages accounts, ledgers, journal entries, flow of money within your microfinance. It's of course also the reporting domain that provides functionality for reporting. So maybe like income statements at year end, the balance sheet at a particular point in time during the year for the MFI, that's all handled by reporting. Reporting is not yet complete, but it's out there and it just needs a little bit more work to be perfect. So now I've actually exhausted the design pattern. I've explained to you a little bit about domain-driven design and the importance that has in our context of Apache Finerac CM. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about command and query responsibility segregation. So now once we have an idea of domain-driven design and how microservices work and which microservice does what, CQRS is the most important thing. Like CQRS, or command and query responsibility segregation, simply states that state-changing models are different from view models. So state-changing models are called commands, and view models are called queries. So let's look at it this way. State-changing models cause a change in our system. So that happens through a write. So when information comes from out of the system and changes the state of the system, that's a state-changing model or a command. And when, as opposed to when information is retrieved from our system, that's called a query. So for scalability reasons, we have to separate these two responsibilities. Queries and commands should not be happening using the same format. So actually separate that. So to foster this pattern of URLs, we store state changes commands in NoSQL databases like Apache Finerac CM, Apache Cassandra, sorry. And we use message queues and event sourcing tools like ActiveMQ to actually put information into specific data sets like MariaDB. Now, Apache Cassandra is important to us, and that is what is used in Apache Finerac CM because it is efficient, especially when you're writing information into a database. It's normally used to store events, so it stores all events that take place in our entire system. And given that Given the projections that, given the fact that this platform is supposed to be used in the context of cloud and there should be scalability, we discover that in the long run, there'll be a lot more writes, which are commands, than reads, which are queries. So within this context, given that Apache Cassandra is good for writing, it's faster when you're writing to it than when you're retrieving information. We use Cassandra a lot, since it's going to handle a lot of that writing. So a single change gets into different types of storage and gets transformed into multiple views. For example, you could have your reporting in a file, and you could trigger a process that edits a reporting file, and you could even store data in a database and provides fast views for particular clients. So one benefit of using this command and query responsibility segregation pattern is that given that command storage holds all state changes, there's a single source of truth in the platform. So for the sake of audit, we're sure that all of our events which have ever transpired on the platform are stored in, are written in Cassandra. So we know that if by some means there's some disparity somewhere, we can always check that. Is this particular transaction stored in Cassandra? And can we look in MySQL, in our underlying database management system, and see that that transaction actually took place? So the use of CQRS in this context is very good for audits. So given that these microservices live in their respective repositories, like we have customer microservice handling members, we have the office microservices handling your organization, it's tempting to think that they live in their own world, but that's not the case. They actually depend on each other. For example, the office microservice, which handles your organization, it depends on the identity microservice for the user IDs. The portfolio microservice depends on accounting and customer microservices. Why? For example, because when loans are created, it concerns specific members of a microfinance. So it touches the customer microservice, and corresponding accounting has to take place for accounting purposes. So it touches the accounting microservice. At the same time, there are some microservices which don't depend on any other microservice. For example, customer and accounting. I mean, those are very, very, very elementary. They don't depend on any other microservice as such. So now I'll explain to you a little bit about the structure of Apache Finirac CN microservices. In each microservice, you observe that for those who have taken time to look at the code, and I'll advise you to definitely do, each microservice has three submodules. Maybe should I call them submodules or pico service or nano services or something? Anyway, let's call it the way that we want. There are three submodules. There's the API submodule, there's a component test submodule, and there's a service submodule. Now, the API submodule is a submodule which contains a declarative REST client, call it FEN client, which makes it easier for Java clients who are external to the system to communicate with your microservice by receiving HTTP request from anywhere, transforming this HTTP request into domain looking form, and forwarding this information to the service submodule. So it contains event constants, which are defined to listen to active MQL events emitted by our microservice, and permissible groups defining the permissions which the microservice offers. So let's look at the API submodule of our microservice as kind of an API gateway. So it's out there, it's actually there to interface with the entire world outside a microservice. So when information is coming in from out of they add microservice, the first place it gets to is the API submodule. Okay, there's actually the component test submodule, which is actually that submodule which tests your entire microservice. So if you actually want to do unit testing and integration testing for your microservice, you want to implement all of that in your component test. This also, we're actually using the component test to actually encourage and emphasize test-driven development within Apache Finerac CN. So those tests are based on a combination of tools like Mockito, JUnit, Spring. Again, Spring comes up. You really want to learn Spring to develop on this platform. Thirdly, there's the service submodule. And the service submodule is actually the heart of the microservice. The service submodule is therefore, it's actually what contains your REST controller, is what contains the business logic of your service, is what contains object relational mappers, and it's basically what talks to the underlying database, maybe MariaDB or MySQL, whatever you decide to use. So that's actually where the real business logic and everything in your microservice is stored. It is Spring Boot deployable and contains a detailed implementation of these CQRS we're talking about. So get calls are implemented within there, and all of your HTTP methods, whether get, put, post, or delete, are all implemented in a REST controller there. So when you're in the service submodule, you know that you're actually in the heart of your microservice. There's some information on the Apache Finerac CN conference page, which Marie-France put up on the Finerac CN project structure. You want to look at that. I'm going to send that link after this. So you want to look at that, and when you look at that, you actually read the entire project structure of the Apache Finerac project. Now, to make work a bit easier within this project, a few custom created annotations were developed. Now, so besides the annotations used from maybe Spring or Spring Boot, whatever, there are a few other ones. There's enable application name, which is language based. It automatically injects a microservices name into another component. There's enable tenant context. It passes a tenant context across components and services. There's enable service exception, which sends custom exceptions meant for the server. And to encourage to implement asynchronous behavior, there are other annotations like enable async, enable Cassandra, enable command processing. So don't worry much. After this, I'm going to actually share my presentations file with the entire community. So you can actually like have a copy of this presentation after this. I'm going to share with you the PDF. I'm going to share with you this document, which will be helpful for you to maybe sit down on your own and actually go through this tutorial. So now that we have an idea and an overview of the entire Apache Finerac CN, let's now go into creating our SMS alert microservice. Now, I'm on IntelliJ. So, to design our SMS alert microservice, we follow a three-step approach which was proposed by the architect of the project, Mr. Mark, which is in one of his emails to the mailing list. And we'll do three things. We're going to clone the template because it's a template microservice which is there to help you to build. It's there for like best practice building a microservice. We're going to clone that. We're going to define our domain, and we're going to implement domain-specific functionalities. So first thing is we clone our template. So, that's pretty straightforward. We need to go to the template microservice on github.com/mifosio template.git. You clone that. Once you clone it, let's say I've cloned it here, I have my SMS alert microservice here, I've cloned that. So I go straight into the settings.gradle file. That's the root. Normally this good project name is it's usually called template when you just clone the template microservice. You need to change that to SMS alert. You go into your share.gradle file. This group, the group of your project, instead of io.mifos.template, you change that to io.mifos.smsalert. Now we go into each of our modules and look for their build.gradle files. So in service, we're going to add this dependency on our API submodule. That's in service. In component test, we're going to add dependence on API and service. And I'm sure in API, we're not going to add anything. So when we have added those dependencies to our module specific build.gradle files, the next thing we want to do is to import our project into IntelliJ. So like I import my project now. In fact, last week I wrote a blog post on Confluence Wiki on how to import Finaract CN microservices into IntelliJ. That will be helpful for you. You want to be able to open all of these microservices in one project. I don't even have all of them open here, but they're quite a number. You want to open them so that you can actually study, you compare, you contrast, and know exactly what you are working on. So we get into these three submodules: component test, API, and service, and refactor. We refactor all of these packages. Normally, when initially you have an io.mifos.template package, you change that to io.mifos.smsalert. Mm-hmm. When we refactor those templates, we get into the service submodule, and we observe that at the beginning we have something like template application and template configuration files. This is Spring Core. You want to now change this class name into SMS alert application and SMS alert configuration Java files. Now, we now get into our resources folder in this service submodule. We open the application.yaml file. And right here under server port context, under context path variable, we change it from template/version1/star into SMS/version1. We go into Bootstrap and we do the same thing. Instead of templates-v1, we have SMS alert.v1. Now, after that, we go into we now go into the API submodule, and what do we see? The API submodule now. Normally, this has to be, this is originally is template manager. This is your fan client. You change this from template manager to SMS alert manager, right? You're customizing the entire project to make from template to a new project. So you have to go through all of this. Event constants. These are event constants are possible occurrences within your microservice. So you want to change that original file from template event constants to, or sample event constants to SMS alert event constants. Now, when you have done all of this, when you have done this basic configuration, so basically you are trying to just move your project, change your project name entirely from template to whatever you call it in our own case here, SMS alert. the next thing you definitely have to do is to do a Gradle publish to Maven local. So you want to actually make sure that all of this compiles smoothly, and from then now you are sure that the edits that you have done are working, and you have a separate project now from template. So developers, ensure that you actually have a build successful notice when you run Gradle publish to Maven local. Now, when we have done this, we have moved across most of the essential files, the build.gradle files, whether they root or in each of the submodules, and we have changed all occurrences of template into SMS alert. I think that we have the SMS alert project, so we have successfully cloned the template. Now, next thing is, we normally have to define our domain and implement the SMS alert features. But now, our domain is not so broad, right? Let's look at it this way. How would we want to alert a member of, remember what we want to do is that we want to send an SMS to a member of a microfinance immediately they become registered in that microfinance. How would we want to do that? Our system currently provides three options. They can be notified using emails, classic telephones, or mobile phones. Those are the three options. Now, let's not forget we're in the context of financial inclusion, and there are a lot of unbanked people in the developing world. So I'll go for mobile phone numbers, because that mobile phone technology is quite ubiquitous in the developing world. So now we know that in our minds, we have in the back of our minds that we want to actually send an SMS using the mobile phone number of our customer. Now, we think again, what actions will lead us to alerting a member of the microfinance about this event? We have already selected that. We have decided that members when a member is created in our microfinance, that person is going to receive an SMS in their phones. So remember, I talked about the fact that these microservices depend on each other. Our SMS microservice in wanting to send an SMS to a member of a microfinance, that automatically means that we'll be interacting with the customer microservice. If we get into the customer microservice and look in the API submodule under this package, io.mifos.customer events, API version 1, we'll open this customer events file and we'll see a lot of constants. These constants dictate basically like references to different events which can take place. So we choose post customer, since we're using REST. So when a customer is actually created, that's kind of like a post request from an external client. That's actually what will cause us to send an SMS to the customer. So when we think of SMS, we think of three things. We think of the sender's phone number, the receiver's phone number, and the text message, which is most best handled as a string. So the next question we ask ourselves is, what APIs are available out there for us to enable people to send SMS? There's Text Belt, there's SMS API, and there's Twilio. I'll personally go for Twilio. So if we look at Twilio's API here, we observe that we need an account SID, an authentication token. At the same time, we don't need this set media URL, which attempts to send a picture. Since we're sending an SMS, we're not sending an MMS. So given the fact that we are interacting with the customer microservice, remember we're building the SMS alert microservice. Given the fact that we're interacting with the customer microservice, we go into the customer microservices, we go into the SMS alert microservice. we open the share.gradle file and we add this line, MIFOS customer 0.01 build snapshot. Because there's going to be some interaction, so we're going to be talking with the customer microservice. You want to add that? Yeah. And we get into the io.mifos.sms alert package, right, within our service. We create a listener. It's a listener, so right. So when we listen to, we're listening to the customer. Immediately, a customer gets created in our customer microservice. We're listening to that. So this code, right, you can actually just copy some of the contents of customer event listener from your customer microservice listener. You put it here, and you use just the methods which you need. For in our own case now, we just need customer created events method. That's all we need. So next we create a sub package here called Twilio. And within that we have a Twilio, we create a Twilio SMS sender class. Now this class has four attributes. Account SID. So this is basically what is going to be doing our Twilio stuff, right? What we saw on the web. So it's going to have an account SID authentication token. It's going to have a sender's phone number, and it's going to have a string for text message. We now adapt that method from the Twilio API, and we simply copy the code and paste it here. And we eliminate the send media URL option because we're not sending an MMS, we're sending an SMS. So with that, we use this this class as a component. So yeah, and remember I talked about Spring. You really need that. We use the add value annotation to actually, as a dependency injection, we get this account SID authentication token, sender number, and federal customer message from a certain file. Now, I don't want to hard code it there, so I'll keep it in my application.yaml file. So right here, I came into this my application.yaml file and I kept my stuff here. So account SID, I keep it here. Authentication token is here. Then now I create federal customer and message will be account created. So when our customer receives an SMS, he's going to receive the SMS account created. So we now go into our customer event listener class. And we see that first of all, this customer event listener, it hosts an instance of the customer microservice. We call it here, let's just call it customer manager. And we have an instance of the Twilio SMS sender. Now we auto-wire these two variables using this constructor. Yeah, and after that we come, this our main focus is on this customer created event, function, this method. So now, first thing is we need to retrieve that particular customer which we are dealing with. So we do, we call customer, we create a customer object, and we assign customer manager.find customer to that. So we look in our customer microservice, we get that particular customer which has been created, and we assign it to this customer. Now we want to test. We test that the customer's contact details are actually of type mobile, because what we want is the customer's mobile phone number. We don't want their email or their fixed phone number, right? So we want their mobile number so that we're sure that whenever they receive the SMS, their phone is going to be close to them. We get this. We assign a receiver number to this string, which we get from the contact details. Remember that it's our customer who is going to receive this SMS, so he has a receiver number. Sender number is from us, so maybe the MFI's own phone number or something. So now we simply now call, since we already have our Twilio sender class, we simply call Twilio sender dot send SMS and you pass the receiver number. And so that's basically it. We have actually implemented the business logic of the SMS alert in the service, microservice. Our API sub module is fine. We have our SMS alert manager, which is our fan client. We have defined our event constants and everything. So from there now, the last step you want to go to is that you want to incorporate all of this for those who want to test, we want to test what you're doing. You want to incorporate all of this into your demo server microservice. So in your demo server microservice, you go into this io.mifos.dev package and you open service runner. The service runner file, it actually defines a list of microservices which you can incorporate into the demo server to test whatever you are doing. So I'm still to work most of this out. Don't forget this tutorial and the code is not 100%. It's not yet in production. So if you look at these microservices, let's say provisioner, identity manager, radio manager, teller manager, and all of this, they are put here so that you can incorporate the microservice into demo server for testing purposes. So incorporate that into demo server. And I'm sure there are other lines of code to add. You add service runner dot SMS alert manager dot queue. In that case, you add a printout if you want to get a particular URI. So you edit this service runner class accordingly to incorporate your SMS alert microservice into the demo server. So let me highlight that running the demo server on most local machines takes nothing less than 30 minutes. So sometimes even close to an hour. So that will take a while. I cannot run that now. Otherwise, we'll not have time to actually exhaust the work we have to do. So after this, I'm going to provide a link to this repository, SMS Alert on GitHub. And most of you can clone it. And you can use information within our Confluence wiki, how to build Fineraxian, which was written by some developers there, to actually build the entire system, and then you actually get the entire thing. So this is a call for developers who are interested in working on this platform to, take this as a small project, get it working, and you start getting your hands dirty with Apache Fineraxian. So I hope that this tutorial on creating a custom microservice on Apache Fineraxian has been helpful to you. I thank you for your kind attention, and we'll use the next few minutes to answer questions from the audience. Any experienced developers on Apache Fineraxian who are on the call can always chime in with some more clarifications as they see fit. So thank you very much. I'm ready for questions and answers.
Okay, thank you, Isaac. Let me unmute everybody that is muted, and then anybody who has a question, they can unmute themselves and ask ahead for Isaac. So are there any questions from the floor? And we'll definitely be sharing the recording, as I know there's not a lot of text on the slides, so it'll be helpful to have Isaac's accompanying explanations to help others go through what he went over.
Yeah. Definitely, I'll share that with you.
Yeah, so just as we're, you know, holding the floor open for any questions that might come in, just some, you know, updates on where we stand with getting the code base officially a part of Apache. So as Isaac said, MIFOS initiative made the initial development of this new framework as MIFOS.io, but its long-term goal and intent was always to put it into Apache. And so right now, you know, we're just going through the compliance procedures and getting the infrastructure set up. So hopefully soon we'll have the new repository in place, such that the MIFOS.io GitHub repository will now be Apache Finnerack CN, and then we'll have corresponding Jira tickets available so we can start moving towards a community-wide discussion around the roadmap for the Generation 3 architecture and getting partners and volunteer developers engaged in contributing to that roadmap. And we're also hoping to have some contributors from the 2018 Google Summer of Code, if we're able to participate, work on Apache Finnerack CN as well. So we're now starting to round that curve and getting close to where we'll be able to have the broader community participate more actively in the development and extension of Apache Finnerack CN. And Isaac will be continuing to do, you know, webinars like this, and also helping build out a developer portal and like API sandbox to allow third parties to come and rapidly evaluate and test out the framework and hopefully prototype new applications and new use cases. So look forward to some of those tools and updates as they come along. And then Isaac, I think Stephen had a question. He just was asking, can you please comment on how security is done using your own or third party?
How security is done, like, what's the question exactly?
Oh yeah, that was as specific as Stephen got, but let me unmute Stephen in case. Yeah, you can come off mute, Stephen, if you want to dive into further detail. But I know, Stephen, that from a architectural perspective, you know, security within the framework is handled. We didn't try and build like components from scratch. It was utilizing most of what's part of Spring security and whatnot, and tried to use those elements. But I'll let Isaac go into more detail, and then if Isaac can't cover everything, we can put that question on the mailing list. And I think some of the architectural documents online go into that.
So basically, I'm trying to ask about, I want to be able to integrate it with, say, Apache Shiloh or something like that.
So all these other security
frameworks, like Apache Shiloh and KeyClock and all that.
Okay,
I'm trying to understand how in relationship with those.
I've not personally looked into how the platform can interact with mentioned like that, but what I can say about security is that the platform is actually built in layers. So a user or some hacker outside the system cannot just access information in the system. So first of all, information comes and gets into that microservice through the API submodule. The API submodule checks, does a lot of checks there, sends it to the service submodule. Service submodule packages that and sends into its REST controller. That's another layer. After the REST controller, it goes into another layer which holds the business logic. After that business logic, it goes into another layer which now interacts with the database repository. So it's layered like that so that at each level, there's the necessary checks, there's validation, and hence security. So there's actually layered security. If security is really a concern, then I mean, you have nothing to fear. That's what I can say about security now. If you are talking about interacting with some other platform, for now, the only thing we've actually thought about is how this can actually interact with the Mozilla platform, which was recently launched by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. So that's what I can say about security, Stephen.
Okay, Yeah, this is fine.
Okay.
Were there any other questions from the floor? If not, I think we've reached the allotted time for the webinar, and I want to thank everybody who came and for those who are listening later on after the fact. Thank you for also registering and joining later. And then Stephen, I think Nazir put a comment there around where you can look at integrating third-party securities, which microservice you could examine. So.
Okay,
thank you, Isaac, for the highly informative and detailed webinar. And
thank you very much, Ed. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, we're looking forward to having more events and tutorials like this as well. So if you have a specific need, please, you know, chime in via the mailing list and let us know, and we'll try and develop that specific resource or material to help you. So thank you, everyone, and have a good morning, evening, or afternoon, wherever you are, and a nice weekend. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much, everyone. Good night.
Thanks.